Hello everyone, welcome to Computer Science E-76. I'm Dan Armendariz and today we're going to continue talking about Android. And in fact, you might recall from last week that we started talking about how we can do some simple layouts. And we didn't get very far in the layouts, but just realized that there's a couple of different ways that we can specify the layout on an activity in an Android application. There's two primary ways to do this. The first one is to do it programmatically, which means that we can generate a bunch of views and insert them programmatically into the activity using some Java code. Alternatively, we can create our layout in XML. And there's actually a pretty good one-to-one relationship between the properties that you can set in XML and the same properties that you can set in Java as well. In fact, a lot of the names match almost exactly. The one exception is actually, or one of the major exceptions is actually shown on the screen right now. This set text method that you can see, which applies to an object, text view object rather, allows you to set the text for this set view or for this text view object. Whereas if you were to specify this same property in XML, you would use the text attribute instead of the set text. But otherwise, a lot of these same things can actually be set using both XML or Java, like this layout width or layout height, just as an example. You could also set using a similarly named property in Java as well. And so we actually showed a couple of examples that use this. One of them was something like this, which was just the first example that we did. And this was just instantiating a text view and putting some text into that text view and then telling the activity the view that we want to use for it. And so hopefully this was relatively straightforward. Now, most of the time, though, unless you really know that you're going to be generating your layout dynamically, it's probably best to create it in XML. So that way you can separate your content and your programming from the layout and design of your application. So that was the point of activity 02, where instead of using some code to instantiate a new text view object and tell the activity that the layout is going to be specified by that view, we will instead use this other method called setContentView and give to that method as a parameter an integer. And this integer is actually specified by this right here, r.layout.main, which is actually just the representation for it. But this uses some resources to actually tell Android where it can find the XML file that represents our layout that we want. So you can imagine that there is somewhere in this application, do we have a layout called main that specifies in XML the layout that we want to use. And in fact, if you recall from the hierarchy that a typical Android application might have, which looks something like this, where we have a source folder, a res folder for resources, the Android manifest.xml file, and some subfolders, especially to the resource folder, which include the drawable and layout folders. You can actually place a number of resources in this res, in this res folder, within some of the subfolders, and you will be able to access them through that sort of trick, that capital R dot what have you, depending on the type of resource that we want to create. And this is very easy to update. In fact, if you wanted to add additional layouts, all you would have to do is just create additional XML files, place them in the layout folder, and the Android SDK will automatically create a separate generated file, this one right here, r.java, which actually maps via an integer and it gives an ID to each of these resources, which allows you to go back and refer to each of these resources that you've placed in the resource file, or in the resource directory. But we'll talk more about this in just a second. What's more important right now is for us to talk about layout. So we said that we can pass in via code a layout. And that's exactly what we do instead in activity 02, where we just give it a very simple layout. This one's actually more complex than the one that we generated programmatically in activity 01, because not only does it contain a text view, it also contains something called a layout, a linear layout. Now, all of these objects are actually just, they're sort of subclasses of exactly the same thing. And what I mean by that is that all of these are view objects. And some of these objects will be view groups. So a layout might be a group, for example, a group of views. And you can have within a group just a variety of things, like maybe some buttons, maybe a text field, maybe the text view like we just saw, maybe a couple of images. whatever you want. You can even have other text groups within those, or not text groups, but view groups within that. So you can nest layouts, you can nest views. And so each of these views eventually form nodes. And so these sort of end nodes are sort of the things that we interact with in the UI. So some of these views, for example, each of these might be a button, or one of them might be a button and another might be an image. And so each of these are actually objects that we can instantiate again in code or using the XML file. Now, widgets and layouts are actually predefined views. So widgets are things that you would actually interact with, like a button or a text view. Whereas a layout is exactly what it sounds like. It's a view group that's designed to provide some layout for a variety of widgets that you might have or other view groups within it. And so what we really want to do then is to create, using XML, a layout and put within it a variety of views so we can create sort of a more complex program. And so you can see some of the other options that are available as well, some of the attributes that are provided in this XML file. We can use the Android namespace and specify some of these options like layout width, layout height, and the text itself. And we talked about how the text, you can actually refer to other resources in that resource folder to be able to pull strings out of a strings.xml file, for example. And we'll talk more about that and how we can actually use that for internationalization in just a little while. But if you take a look at some of these other attributes, layout width, layout height, hopefully some of these are actually pretty self-explanatory, where we can set the width of the text view to fill the parent, or we can set the height to match that of the content. So if we were to actually take a look at what the borders of these views would be, this would be sort of a very simple application. And so first, if we look at what this would look like just running on a device, this is just very simple, it's this. But if we could see the borders of each of these views, we would see that there would be a border around hello from activity 02, that would be as tall as the text and as wide as the device itself, because the linear layout was also it was meant to fill the parent in both width and height. And since the activity basically gave it almost the entirety of the screen, we can then imagine that layout will be as big as the screen itself. So what if we wanted to actually start using some of these views? Well, that's the point of some of the subsequent activity examples, in particular code 03. So what we're using here is basically the same code, but what's more important, of course, is the XML file that specifies the layout that we are interested in. So in this one, this is a little bit more complicated. We can see that we have a linear layout with a couple of text view objects that are nested within it as children. So notice that we have a linear layout that is an open tag. It's sort of like HTML, like we talked about, except there's not at all, the elements are not at all the same, but it works in the same way in that it's very nested and it's just a regular XML file. So we have as children to this linear layout element, variety of text views. So all of these text views then are children to this linear layout, and each of these have their own properties. So we can see that we have a couple of things here like text available in each of these text views where we increment basically just a counter. Now this is just meant to be, again, another very basic example, but to show you some of the other things that we can do. We can change some of the attributes to not only change the size of the text, but also the font color as well. And we can see that through some of these, like the second text view right here has a change in text size to 14 point, whereas the first one is 16 point. So we imagine that the text in the first one is going to be much larger than the text in the second one. Now we can see some other things, like we can change the typeface in this third one to monospace. And I think the fourth one even has an attribute to change the color. So we can change the color as well using the text color attribute. And a list of all of these attributes, again, you can find in the developer site of the developer page on developer.android.com. But what's pretty important to realize here are what some of these different layouts actually do. So this is a linear layout, and what that means is that all of the children are going to be stacked linearly, one on top of the other. In this case, we've told the orientation of this linear layout to be vertical, which means that we're going to have a text view at the top, and then whatever's the next child is going to be directly underneath that, then whatever's the next child is going to be directly underneath that. There's not going to be any views that are side by side, just because this is a linear layout and we're specifying that we want all of these views to go one right after the other in vertical orientation. Now, if we change this to be horizontal, then it would be the opposite. We would actually see one text view and then right next to it another text view to the right, then to the right another text view, so on and so forth, dependent on how we want ours to look. So if we want to run this and see how it will look on a device, we are going to build it, and hopefully it will show up on the screen over here, which you can see. Now you can see there's the four text views, all in different sizes, where the third one is a monospaced font, and the fourth one actually has some different color specified for it. Now if we move on and start taking a look at some of the other ones, such as Activity 04, we'll realize that we have some other options that are available to us within each of these layouts. So if we take a look at the layout XML file, notice that we are doing something a little bit more complicated. In this case, what we want to do is to have a doubly nested linear layout. But what we want is to ultimately have a more complex UI, so that we could have maybe some buttons on here that are perhaps right next to each other, but then below that we could probably have something else like a text edit box or something similar. So if we take a look here, we can see that we have linear layout. The parent of this is a vertical linear layout, which means that things are going to be stacked one on top of the other. Then the first child to that is another linear layout, but this one has an orientation of horizontal, which means that we're going to have our first object in this linear layout is going to be a horizontal linear layout, and we have two children here. So we have two buttons. Then underneath that, because we go back to our original linear layout, we can see that we have a couple of edit text boxes. So then what is the layout of this page going to look like? Just generally, we have two buttons and we have two text boxes that allow us to edit. And what is it going to look like generally? Right, so the buttons will be at the top and right next to each other. Then what about the text boxes? Right, so then underneath that we have our first text box, and underneath that first one do we have our second text box. And we can take a look at what this would look like, of course, by compiling. Now, of course, you do, in Eclipse, you are provided with a graphical version where you can actually see a preview of what this layout will look like. I think this is pretty good, pretty neat, and you can actually customize it depending on the size of the screen and some other functions. But I've also noticed that there are sometimes it interprets it a little bit differently than an actual Android or the emulator device itself. So it's always a good idea, once you've got a complex layout that you think looks good, to verify that it's what you expect before you actually start programming with it. So if we are to switch now back to the actual device, we'll see this is exactly what we saw. There's two buttons at the top, my button and my button two, then a text box underneath it, and then a much larger text box underneath that. Now you'll notice though that there's something kind of funny about these text boxes. In particular, one is really kind of small and the other one is very, very large. In fact, it's taking up the entirety of the screen. And this is provided to us by some of the other options that we found in the XML file. If we notice that they're both text boxes, but one of them allows us to have multiple lines, and the other one is not specified as such. And so we can see a couple of the attributes that we see here. First of all, this bottommost one, the big one, you can see has a single line attribute that's set to false, which means that it is allowed to be multiple lines, so that gives the layout a clue to figure out how to draw this layout on the screen. Now we can also provide a minimum number of lines to it, just to make clear that it's not a single line text box, and that's provided here by the min lines attribute right there. Now notice that we have a layout weight object, right, or a layout weight attribute right here. That tells the layout engine how important various items are within your layout. If you have some objects that have a higher layout weight than others, then they're going to be given more precedence. So in this case, because this one is allowed to be multiple lines and it's given a much higher weight than all of the other objects in this layout, it's allowed to sort of grow and take up whatever amount of screen space it can without interfering with the minimum sizes of the other ones that are above. And so you can create more complex layouts like this by just giving different weights to different objects and using these linear layouts to do sort of a similar thing. Now, this is all well and good, but there are other There are other layouts that are available to us as well if we want to do some perhaps more complex layouts in our application. So for example, let's say that we wanted to actually have something that looked like a table. There are actually table layouts that allow you to specify columns and rows and create a much more complicated layout like that without having to use all sorts of nested linear layouts. So hopefully the differentiation between nested linear layouts and tables is sort of clear. But if we wanted to see what this one might look like, it looks basically just like this. So we have here a table with some text on it that includes, it has three columns. The far left column has an asterisk to show which one is the currently selected layout. Then there's some of the other layouts that we have, that one of which we've talked about and one that we haven't quite talked about quite yet. Now back to this XML file, we can see that there are a couple of interesting things about the table layout as well. First of all, you specify as the parent the table layout. Then within that table layout, you specify rows. So just by using this table row, you indicate that this is one row and all of the child objects within it are the columns that make up that row. So we can see here, okay, there's one row and then there's two text views within it, and each of those was given some text. So linear layout and then a description that we saw on the right side of that. Now, of course, padding is sort of similar to what you would see in sort of the HTML CSS world, where you can pad the outside of this object a little bit to give it some space from the objects around it. Now, the gravity is actually tells Android how to behave in terms of its content, that view's content. So in this case, the gravity, the right gravity here, applies to the text within this text view object. So just by giving it a gravity of right, are we saying that we want to right align the text as we can see in the layout here? So that's how we were able to right align this text here. Now, moving on to some of the other rows, we can see that we have now in this table row a third column, the two other text views. So hopefully this is sort of self-explanatory from here on out with the remainder of this text view. Now, one of the other layouts that I think is interesting is the relative layout. And I think you'll find that you might use this one fairly often. And I'm just going to sort of get this started on the device so that you can see what it looks like in just a moment. But what this one does is it allows you to specify relative to each other where the children of this layout should be placed. So for example, you might put a text view somewhere and then you want to place some buttons directly underneath it. You can specify via attributes where each of these buttons would go. So we have a relative layout then as the parent to all of these objects. You can see that we have a couple of things here. We have a text view that specifies so this is just an example that we might use if we wanted to enter a student's name, for example, into an application. So we have then a text view that allows us to say what this edit text box is going to provide to us, or what you should enter into that box. And specifically, we are going to say in the text view that this is the name of the student. Then to the right of that, do we want to have, or rather underneath that, do we want to have an edit text box that allows us to enter then the name of the student via the keyboard? Then below that, do we want to have two buttons that can either accept or cancel our selection? So to see what this actually looks like on a device is here. So we can see at the very top of the activity, we can see that text view that says name of student. Then underneath that is the text or the edit text box that allows us to do some text input. And then below that, do we have two buttons that are adjacent to each other, one that allows us to cancel and the other that allows us to accept this this choice. Now, how does this actually work? Well, realize that we have to do a couple of things. First of all, to each of these objects in the relative layout, we have to provide an ID to it. This is going to be useful not only for the layout, but also when we start interacting with these objects, these layout objects programmatically. We need to be able to contact each of these by some ID that they might have associated with them. So we can see that the text view already has an ID using this ID attribute, and we use this sort of thing that we talked about last week, this @ symbol plus ID slash my label. And this is a special symbol that Android will understand. It will actually parse this with that at sign. It will parse this string and try to figure out what you are trying to say. So in this case, with the at sign, you're saying, okay, I want to actually do something with this string. It's not actually a string that it should take literally, but in fact, I should try to interpret what this string means. The plus means that I want to add, and then of course the ID is hopefully self-explanatory. So I want to add a new ID whose name is my label. Now, once that's generated, once this is actually running on the device, then there is going to be an ID associated with this text view, and the label for this ID is going to be my label. And we'll be able to reference that at a later point when we're actually interacting with these objects programmatically. Now, notice that we're giving in a similar way, we're giving IDs to the edit text box and the two buttons as well, and we're just naming them very, very simply. They do, of course, technically have to be unique, but technically they only have to be unique within the portion of the tree that you are searching. Generally, you're going to be searching in the entire ID tree, so it's generally a good idea to make sure that all of your IDs are actually unique, just to make that clear. Now, if we have this ID number students, realize that we can now reference that ID in this edit text ID, not only programmatically, but also in the subsequent objects as well. Yes.
Curious about the uniqueness if I have an accept button on a different activity in a different layout, does that have a different name or is it just within the view?
So does if I have an accept button within a different activity, does it have to have a different name or is it just within the view? So again, it depends where you are searching for IDs. Generally, when you are looking for IDs, the context, I believe, is within the activity itself. So all of these would be unique to this activity. Now, it is possible, of course, to search for IDs outside of it. Or no, it actually might be by namespace. So I think it really depends on it definitely depends on the context that you are searching for an ID. And I think it might be by namespace. And right now, we're specifying that this ID is in the local namespace. And so it might actually contradict with another activity. I actually haven't tried that. I always name them uniquely across all activities in an application, but that's something that would be good to try. Yes?
Going back to gravity, what if I want to align a table cell in two dimensions, like vertically in the center and to the right? Is there a special value for that, or are there two different
attributes? Yes, in a table layout, if you want to have it within a cell, align something, say, to the middle horizontally and then to the right. So align it centered and then to the right. Yes, it's possible to specify that with attributes, but it might be something different than gravity. I recommend looking at the specifics for the table layout to find out how that might actually be possible. But it is possible to specify those to specify that that amount of precision for positioning the text. Okay, now we can actually reference all of these IDs at a later point in time, not only programmatically, but also in the XML file as well. In fact, you'll notice that this edit text specifies already its placement relative to the initial text view. We can see that in this attribute right here, the layout below. Now notice that in this layout below, we're actually saying to the layout engine that what we want to do is place this edit text object below, in terms of layout, below this object right here that has this ID. Now this ID, notice that we don't have a plus symbol in this at ID. It's because we're not generating a new ID, but instead we are referencing the ID that's provided by this tag, my label. So it would not work if we had removed the at ID and the slash. If we had just done this, then it would just consider this to be a raw string. It wouldn't interpret this information. So again, this at sign is important for us to look up the ID called my label. Now similarly, let's say that we want to move these buttons underneath this edit text box. And in fact, all of this is read, this XML file is read linearly, which means that all references to IDs must already be created prior to your using them. So this would not work if I had done at ID my label and then the my label ID was actually below the edit text. You would actually get an error from the XML file. This is not going to work out because it must be created before you can do this. So for this reason, you can imagine that it might be difficult to do some things from the bottom up, but this allows you to at least do a relative layout in this way. So below this, we want to have these two buttons that are side by side, and notice that we are still giving each of these buttons an ID. So in this case, we're giving the accept button an ID of accept, and we are saying that we want this button to be below the number of students, but also we want to align to the right, the very right of the screen. So we are saying that we want to align parent right equals true, where the parent is this outside relative layout. Yes?
The orientation for this layout were horizontal instead of vertical. Would below still be the identifier that things move to the right, or would we use a different?
If the layout were horizontal rather than vertical. So there's no, in a relative layout, there's no concept of sort of horizontal and vertical like there was in linear layout. So what we are doing, when we specify that something should be below it, it's going to be actually below it on the screen. It's not going to be relative to some specifier like vertical or horizontal, just because that doesn't make sense for the relative layout. That attribute made sense for the linear layout, but not for this one, because we have precision elsewhere through these other attributes by specifying where in the layout do we want each of these IDs to appear, or each of these objects to appear. So that sort of nullifies that whole idea of orientation. That was important, again, for linear, but probably not so necessary here. Now, next to that accept button, do we want to have the cancel button? So notice that we have a couple of things. First, we want to say that the button should be to the left of the accept button, so that's exactly what we specify, and also that the top of the button should align with the top of the button that it's next to. So we can specify both horizontally and vertically where each of these objects should be placed. Yes?
If you didn't do the alignment on the cancel button, where would it be in relation to the button?
Which alignment? Do you mean the align top?
Align, yes, top.
So if we removed the align top, and we took a look at it, it would actually, because we haven't specified in a vertical sense where that object should be, it's going to put it at the top. So generally, for each of these objects, we need to tell not only horizontally, but vertically, where each of these objects should be placed. So we said to the left of the accept button, so it placed it to the left of that, and notice that there was a little bit of a space between the accept and cancel button. That's because we put some padding to the left of the accept button just to give it a little bit of space between the two buttons, just to make it sort of friendlier for fingers. And had we not done that, of course, they would be squished together, but then the cancel button would be right to the left, or I should say that differently, it directly to the left of the accept button. And had I not specified vertically where it should be, then it will go to the very top as well. Now, sometimes you don't have to specify both of these dimensions. For example, in the edit text box, we actually specified that the width should fill the parent, so it was as wide as the parent was going to be anyway. So it really doesn't matter if it tried to put it at the very far left of the screen or the very far right, because it would look as though it were in the same place anyway. Yes?
Does it automatically adjust for portrait?
I'm sorry? Does it automatically adjust for portrait and landscape? Yes, this layout will actually automatically adjust for it, just because then it knows, and that's one of the nice things about the relative layout, is that even if the screen were to be turned on its side, for example, and so it were wider than it was tall, what will happen is that the name of the student, it will still be the same linear layout, except what will be different is that the text edit box will be much wider to fill the remainder of the screen, and the cancel and accept buttons would still be on the far right side, but they would just feel perhaps a little bit farther just because of their placement on the screen. They would just be farther off to the right. But yes, using relative layout, that's one of the advantages to it, is that it then is a lot easier to modify based on different size screens and also for different orientations of the phone itself. Any other questions? Yeah. Are there any pitfalls to using the graphical layout directly? It might be Let's see. So I think personally, I think it's personal preference, whatever you might want to do. If your layout is relatively simple, you might be able to get away with just dragging each of these objects from the list on the left and putting them on there. I think it's probably quite reasonable to do that and then to fine tune your layout with the XML file itself. It really is your own personal preference. You might find that it does something that you like or don't like. It just, again, is whatever I think you feel comfortable with. Is there another question? Yes.
What happens if you put multiple views to, let's say, the right of a single parent?
What happens if you put multiple views to the right of a single parent? In what, what's, are you thinking of an example? So it's actually, so the layout actually doesn't help you in the sense of trying to correct any layout problems you might have. So it's entirely possible for you to place objects underneath other objects so that they're obscured, or even possibly, I think it depends on the layout engine, but it might even be possible to put them off screen so that they're not shown whatsoever. So you have to be careful when you're using this layout. I've definitely written layouts and, you know, pulled my hair out as I tried to get it just right and trying to figure out why certain things were, you know, always being centered and when they shouldn't be. It's sort of a delicate dance, I think, to get the layout to be just the way you want it. And I think eventually with experience you'll get more comfortable with how each of these properties work, because I think looking at an example like this makes it sort of obvious how this works, but then when you're actually sitting down and you have a UI in mind and a layout that you actually want to create, actually implementing that is sort of a beast in and of itself. And so it's possible then there's no guarantees that you're not going to have layout problems, just like we saw when we removed this align top and we saw the graphical layout. I mean, this is not a good thing necessarily to have a button right on top of an edit text. It's confusing and it's ugly, and so there's no protections against that. It's really whatever the layout engine, and the layout engine depends on the layout itself, because each of these layouts they're responsible for drawing their own all of their child views, and it really depends on how each of these are implemented for them to decide how they will actually display them on the screen. Yes.
When we specify grab content for the width of an empty edit text box, how does the layout determine the intended number of characters in that text box?
So if we change the layout width not to fill content but to wrap the content instead, again, it makes no guarantees. It will become the minimum size possible. And then as we start to put text into it, will it grow over time? So if I were to actually then specify some text within this edit text box by doing Android text equals this is some text, then we will see that it has actually grown to match. Yes, you can actually, in almost all cases, like the width and the height, you can actually specify raw width. So you could, for example, say 50 pixels, and that should actually be 50 pixels wide. The problem with doing this is that you're then hard coding in the size of the edit text, and it may look great on the emulated device or whatever device you're testing it on, but as soon as you use another device that changes screen size or resolution or any number of factors, then it's probably not going to be sized very well. They do have other units as well, what's it called? I think DP, that actually depend on the size of the pixels on the device itself. And you can then specify, perhaps with a little bit more resolution, the size of the apparent or the apparent size that it should actually be shown on the screen. And so this is generally better than using pixels. And almost always where you see that people recommend that you do not use pixels or sort of the absolute specifications for any of these attributes, just because you might get into trouble with the layout on different devices. But doing something like this, where you can actually modify or where you can specify that the unit should be based on the size of the screen, it's generally a bit more kosher. Okay. Now, we're starting to get to a pretty interesting layouts, I think. And specifically, we now have some text box on here. And man, I've messed this up pretty well. We have text box on here, and we have a couple of buttons. But if we were to actually look at this on the device and I tried to use this thing, I mean, these buttons, they're not doing anything. I can still type text in here, but if I click accept or if I click cancel, nothing happens. So there's something that we have to do now to interact with each of these devices. Now that we know how to lay out our UI on the screen, we have to do something to be able to interact with each of these views programmatically. And to be able to do that, we have to do something that's sort of similar to what we've seen in perhaps JavaScript or some of these other languages, and we have to start dealing with handlers. So whenever something happens on the screen because the user has done something, then a handler must deal with that information. And so we can have events that can be fired, and we have to capture these events for us to do something with it. And specifically, if I'm tapping on one of these buttons, then that means that I want to do something with it. And so there is an event called an on-click event that allows that I can capture, and I can actually write some code to interpret what is happening when I have actually captured an on-click event. So that is the purpose of the next activity, activity 07. And if we take a look at what's going on, this is exactly the same layout that we just saw before. So it has the name of the student, the edit text box, the two buttons, and we actually now want to do something with all of these buttons and with this edit text box that we have. So the very first thing we're going to do, of course, is in the start of our activity lifecycle on create, we have to set the view. We have to set the content view of our activity so that all of this stuff is then rendered and displayed on the screen. That's the first thing. And generally, this is almost always the first two lines of code that you're going to use in your onCreate method. The exception, super.onCreate always has to be the first thing, but if you are generating your view programmatically, then perhaps you won't have set content view as the second thing. But generally, these are going to be the first two things that we'll see in almost all of the subsequent applications. So now what we have to do is interact programmatically with these accept and cancel buttons. So realize that each of these things that we placed on here, their names in XML correspond very well to their names in Java. In fact, there is a button class that has been implemented that refers to each of these to these views. So now with this button, I can instantiate a new variable, or rather I can create a new variable called accept of type button, and I want it to be equal to the view that it actually exists on the screen. And for this to happen, I have to find that view. I have to find the view. I have to find the widget that exists on the screen so that I can then set accept equal to that same view. And in order for us to do that, there's a very useful method called findViewById. And again, because we've added those IDs to the XML file, it's then interpreted and added to that generated r.java file, we can then refer to that same ID through this same method that we've done for some of the strings that we saw before. So r.id.accept is the same integer ID that refers to this very same button. So finding the view by ID will then return the view object that is found at that particular ID. Now, this is just a view. We have to cast it now to a button so that we can actually then get all of the methods and properties associated with the button view, the button subclass of the view that like we can see here. Okay, so now a button. One of the methods that a button actually has is to set the onClick listener so that when that button is clicked, there's some function that gets fired to perform some action. Now, we can see here that there is a respond to click, and we'll look to see what that is in just a moment. But just to show you that we have now done the similar thing for the cancel button, we've now found, we also have to find the view for the cancel button, put it into a new variable that we've called cancel, and also set an onClick listener for the cancel button as well. Now, in order for us to be able to respond to this click, we have to do something here. So realize that we have now a new variable that is of type onClickListener. And this onClickListener variable is just going to be a method that just calls this onclick or rather it's going to be a class onclick listener class, and we have to override a method called onclick to be able to do something with that click. So this, whenever we have an onclick listener set, and then we're working on the display, and we actually click on one of these objects, there is a method that gets called, this onclick method, and into it gets passed the view that was clicked on. So what this means is that we can have one onclick method, and we can pick in the method which of the buttons had actually been selected, and then we can do something based on the button that has actually been selected. So notice that there's a context thing here and a char sequence text. We'll talk about that in just a moment. But if we scroll down, we can see how we can determine which button has actually been clicked by getting the ID of the view that's been passed into it, that's been passed to us, and using a switch statement to figure out which ID matches that ID that has actually been clicked. So in the case that the person has clicked r.id.accept, then we're going to do something. In the case that somebody else has, or that same person has clicked the cancel button, then the ID of the view that's been passed into our onClick method is going to match that of r.id.cancel, and we are going to do something else. Now, just to sort of be sure that in case for some reason our onClick method is fired and none of those IDs have actually, or that view that's passed to us doesn't actually match anything that we're handling, then we're going to also deal with the default case as well. Now, notice that we have here a text variable, and we're setting a string into as the value for this text variable. And in fact, that's what we're doing. In Android, we have this this idea of a char sequence, which is just, it's what it sounds like. It's just a string. It's just a sequence of chars. And we are just going to set a string equal to, or we're just going to set text equal to a string dependent on what is happening. Now, we have to do something now with this. And generally, what we're going to do is want to perhaps notify the user that something has happened. So before I continue along, I just want to now sort of show what is happening on this device itself. So now this is the same layout that we had seen before, but this is the new activity. And so if I click one of these buttons, for example, accept, notice that there is a little message that appears at the bottom center of the screen that said accept push. So if I click cancel instead, then we can see the other button was pushed. Cancel was pushed. So this now is sort of an example that throws a lot of new stuff at us. We're first connecting programmatically our code with the layout or with some of the widgets that we placed in the layout. Then we're setting an onClick handle so that if one of these objects is clicked, then we can do something with it dependent on which one has actually been clicked. Then we haven't even seen the code for this yet. We're showing a message to the user. And this message is called a toast. And it's one of the few ways that we can notify the user of some particular action. Another way that we can notify the user is to actually put a notification at the very top. That uses a different method altogether. But toast is just something that's very quick, very dirty, and it's just very easy for you to show a very short string to the user when you have something to tell them. And as you'll see a little bit later, we'll actually have a better way of notifying the user of some errors as well. So in order for us to show a toast, then we have to have just a couple of lines of text. So we're going to create a new variable called toast, and we're going to give it a type of toast, and we're going to make run this toast.makeText method. And within it, we're going to pass something called a context, which is this thing that I did some hand-waving at before. The context basically just refers to the application itself. That's all the way up here, get application context. We didn't have to split this off into a separate variable. We could have just passed it the result of get application context directly. But this just tells the toast in what context it should be displayed. Then the text itself, and this text is of type char sequence, as we had seen above. So all of this text that we had set up there is now going to be displayed in the toast. And then finally, the final parameter in this make toast method is going to be a duration. And in this, we're going to tell the toast how long it should actually appear. There's two options. There's toast.length short and toast.length long. So you can pick your poison, and in this case, I don't like it to be too obnoxious, so short is just fine. Then once we've made a toast, then we can tell the toast to display with toast.show. Oops. Eclipse can sometimes be a little bit annoying, as I'm sure some of you have now had the experience with, but that's not my fault. Okay, so with all of this now, have we been able to do quite a few things. We've been able to, like I said, connect to the buttons, do something when the button is pushed, and start to display notifications to the user. But this is not perhaps the best way of providing an on-click handler. And the reason for that is we are actually creating a new object altogether, new on-click listener, and we're passing into, and so we are, we're basically just instantiating a new copy of this on-click listener and overriding, or we're implementing this on-click method, but there must be a better way that we can do the same sort of thing. And in fact, there is, so that we can use a little bit less memory, we can use this method that's found in activity 08 itself instead. And in this one, notice the way that our class declaration has changed. So not only do we extend the activity, because it's still an activity, but also we are going to implement the on-click listener and another one on long-click listener as well. And so this means that there's this on-click listener that we want to implement, this interface that we want to implement, which means that we are going to guarantee that we are going to create a couple of methods. In the case of the on-click listener, we're going to create the on-click method. But now, because we're implementing that in the same class, we can just make it as another method within the same activity. We don't have to do this complicated other bit of code that you'd seen before where we wanted to create a new on-click listener. We can just implement that method directly within our activity. And also, whenever we want to implement an event handler for long-click events, we can implement the on long click event as well. So what is happening in this code? Let's see what might be a little bit different about this. Hopefully now it is not going to be much of anything except that we are going to be doing something a little bit different. So if I click cancel, you can see that it says cancel has been clicked. I'll do it again so that it's more apparent down there. Then if I click accept, accept has been clicked. Now if I push and hold accept, you can see that we are also handling another event as well where the button has been clicked and held for a certain amount of time. That's that on long click that we had seen as well. So doing the same thing for cancel. So basically this has pretty much this can do the same amount of stuff that our previous version could do, but it's done perhaps a little bit more simply, and it allows us to implement an on long click handler as well. So if we start from the beginning, it's very, very similar to what we had seen, except whenever we want to set an on-click listener, we don't have to pass it the name of a variable. We can just pass it this same object, or we can just say this. So this class is going to be responsible for handling this event, this on-click event. Same thing for the on-long-click listener. We have to also specify a handler for an on-long-click event, and we can do that with this the appropriately named method setOnLongClick listener as well. We want to do the same thing, of course, for cancel, and then as soon as we've finished this, we can then click and long-click on each of these buttons and do different things. So pretty much what happens is very, very similar. We can see that we now have two methods, on click and on long click. Each of those is passed a view, and we do the same thing where we switch dependent on the ID that's been passed to us based on the view. Then we can determine which button has been pushed. We can set our char sequence equal to one of two things, and then we can actually display the message. So in this case, I've just moved the toast to a separate method just so that it's a little bit easier to display a message to the user just by calling a show message method and passing into it as parameter a char sequence text field. And so in this way then, can we do this sort of thing. Now, basically, there's another thing that we can do as well. Now, what we had done is we decided which string that we wanted to use dependent on the button that was clicked, but realized that there's other methods available to us in the view as well. And in fact, you can cast the view as the type of object that you know it's going to be. So in this case, we know that the views that are going to be clicked are going to be the buttons, because those are the only two views that we had set to have on click on long click handlers. And so we can then cast the object to be a button. And then from that, we have access then to all of the buttons methods as well. And we can see that the button has a method called getText, which just represents the text that was available to us on the button itself. And so we can then use the show message this way. So this is just a different way of implementing pretty much the same thing. But most of the time, I think if you have multiple buttons especially, you're going to implement an on-click handler like this, in that you'll have a switch or a really messy, long nested if statement, if-else statement, and you will have you will determine which one has been clicked with that by using a switch and casing it in this way. Now, I had mentioned before that there's probably a different way that we can provide some information to a user besides a toast. The toast is useful, but it's sort of like an analog of the alert box in the Android world. You don't want to use it too much. It's good for some things. It's good for short messages that should notify the user about something quickly and be done and out of the way, but it's not very good for long-term messages. It's not very good when you need to query the user and you have to actually ask them a question and provide some boxes like okay or cancel. That's something that we might have be better implemented using a dialog box. And so similarly then, in activity 09, do we want to still work with this same layout, but instead of using a toast, do we want to use a dialog box? So how then does activity 9, how is it different then from activity 08 to see that? Let's take a look here. So in this case, let's say that I actually just type the name, some random name of a student, and click, I haven't implemented that. That must be the next one. Oh no, wait, is this still activity 08? It is. Uh-oh, that's the problem here. Reinstallation, okay, so I've actually had this running before, and rather than just delete it, I will just rerun it here. Okay, so here if I click accept, we can see now that we are provided with a different notification. Whoops, just kidding. I can see that, but you can't. Okay, so here we can see that we have a different notification altogether that actually tells us what text has been typed in the edit box. So just to see what I did, I typed in some text into the edit box above, and I clicked accept, and we can see that I've entered this text here. Now notice what happens to the view or to the activity in the background. It's gone dark. And in fact, this dialog that appears on top, it captures all of the buttons and all of the pushing that I do on the screen and all of the button mashing that I might do from registering through the activity underneath. Now, this is actually sort of an activity that appears. It is still part of our activity, but it appears on top of our activity and soaks up all of this stuff so that I cannot interact with the activity that is visible underneath. Now, you'll notice that this toast that we had seen before, it doesn't allow us to really do anything interesting. Now we can actually do something interesting. We can actually tell the user what they've entered, but also if we want to click cancel, then we can see that another dialog box appears altogether asking me if I want to cancel. If I hit no, then what happens is I go back to my application, but if I hit yes, then the activity is closed, or rather the task itself has been closed as well. So going back to it, let's see then what is different about this code. Notice that we have a bunch of stuff up here. There's some stuff here, and we'll talk about again what this is in just a little bit. Of course, we have to implement an on-click listener in our class declaration up top so that we'll be able to do something when each of these buttons are pushed. So now it's basically the same thing in the onCreate method that you had seen, in that we want to set the view. We want to find the views, the buttons that are in our layout and assign them to accept and cancel buttons. And we also want to find the text field by ID. So what we're doing is we're just linking all of these text views, all of these objects, these view objects that exist in the layout to some variables within our application. And notice that what we are doing is we are creating these as field variables so that they can be found from any method in this class itself. Whereas before we had created them locally only to the onCreate method, we now want to be able to continue interacting with these buttons at other in other methods as well. So we are putting them outside of the onCreate method as well. So if a button is clicked, then that means that we have to go down to the onClick handler that's implemented right here. And this is almost exactly what you'd seen before, except now what we're doing, instead of setting a variable equal to some text, is we're running a method called showDialog, and we're passing into it an ID. Now this ID we actually have to manually create. It's not automatically generated for us, but we can just define a couple of IDs dependent on the different number of dialogues that we actually want to display. So as you saw in the implementation, there were two dialogues that we had. There was one that showed the text that the user had entered into the edit text box, and there was another one that asked the user if they were sure that they wanted to quit the application. So there's then two IDs that we have to generate. And doing this with constants is generally a better thing to do, just because then you're going to be referencing these IDs a number of times. And it's better to be able to reference them by name, especially if you ever have to modify one of the IDs themselves. It's better to do it by name than it is by perhaps hard coding it in. So in this case, we have a dialog cancel ID and a dialog accept ID. This could be named anything, but I thought that this would be sort of easy to remember and easy for us to know what it is we are looking at in terms of this constant in our application. So what this method, showDialog, is, this is not a method that we implement. This is a method that exists in the activity, and it tells the activity that we want to show a dialog. Now, by itself, it's not going to do anything. We have to implement a couple of methods ourselves. And one of those methods is called onCreateDialog, as you can see up here. Now, when we have created this method, known as onCreateDialog, the basic chain that happens is that what we're going to do in this dialog is what we're going to do in this method is actually create a dialog object. We're going to build a dialog object that's going to include the number of buttons, what each of those buttons should do, what the text is going to be in this dialog, all of these sorts of properties that are associated with the dialog box. Then, dependent on the ID of the dialog that's been picked, we're going to return one of the dialogues that we've created. Notice that the return type of this method is dialog. That's exactly what we're returning, is an object, is a dialog object that the activity will then show after it's been created. So the basic chain is then this. Once a button has been clicked, we go to our onClick handler, and we decide, dependent on the view that's been picked, we want to show a dialog, but we have to decide which one based on the view, or rather than of the ID that has been clicked on screen. So we want to show the dialog of the accept ID, for example. So show dialog accept ID, we pass into it the integer of the dialog that we want to display. This method does some stuff, but one of the first things that it does is to call our method onCreateDialog, and our method is then, again, responsible for creating the dialog associated with that ID, including all the buttons, all the text, all that stuff, returns that back to the method that called it, and then that method will then show the dialog on the screen. So how does this work? Well, in order for us to create a dialog, we're going to have to return some dialog to it. So we're going to create a variable called dialog that is of type alert dialog. And at first, it's not going to be anything. It's just going to be set equal to null. But eventually, we're going to want to return this dialog object, just because that is what we are tasked to do in this method. Now, in order for us to create a dialog, we have to create another variable that is of type alertDialog.builder. This builder class will actually allow us to create the dialog. Eventually, after we've done creating it using this builder class, we will then create the dialog from that, put that built dialog into our dialog variable, and then return that to the user, or not to the user, but to the calling method that will then display the dialog for us. Now, notice again that we have two IDs. We have either the dialog accept ID, or the dialog cancel ID. And different dialogues are built dependent on the ID that has been selected. So again, we're going to use this trick of having a switch and picking which ID has been selected just using this method here. So with the switch ID, we will decide which one we want to do. In the case of the cancel ID, we're going to start building a dialog. And we can do that using the builder variable that we had just done. And there's a few methods. And again, there's a whole list of methods that you can find in the development page. But some of the most important ones, I think, are this. So set message, that's sort of the most important one. That's the text that's going to be displayed in the dialog box itself. And in this case, this is the text that we had seen before. Are you sure you want to cancel? And within this dialog, we now want to have two buttons. We want to have a yes button. Yes, we are sure we want to cancel, and a no button. So that's the next two things that are found here. Now notice that this method, this builder.setMessage method, actually returns the same type, this alert dialog.builder type. So this means that we can chain a variety of these methods together. That's why you see .setMessage and then .setPositiveButton and then down here .setNegativeButton. We can just change, or rather we can chain all of these methods together while we build our dialog. So we set we want to do the set positive dialog button to yes. So that's then from there we have to have an on-click listener for that button because it is of course a button. And the way that we can finish, or the way that we can close an application, is just to use this.finish. Just tell the activity that we want it to finish. Now the other one is no, and what that means is that we want the dialog to actually disappear altogether. So then we will tell the dialog. Notice that one of the variables that's passed to us in the on-click method in this dialog interface on-click listener is the dialog itself. We can tell the dialog to just close and be done with it. Now, similarly, can we do something for the accept button where we build the accept button as well? You've entered the text, and then we reference the text from that view object. Set cancelable means, you know, that back button that exists on Android buttons. If that's set equal to false, then you can't push that back button to dismiss the dialog box. If it's normally it's set to true, which means you can dismiss it with that. Set neutral button, that's neither affirmative nor bad. And you can just do something with it. In this case, we are just closing it. Now, in either case, we have to then build the dialog from our, we have to then create the dialog from our builder object. And then when we're done, we will return the dialog that we have created. Did I see a question? This ID, the ID, which ID?
On click.
Dialogue, then integer ID. Int ID, because in order for us to implement the onClick method, one of them is this parameter int ID. We just have to define that. This is the method that we have to, these are the parameters that we have to define in order for us to implement the onClick method, even if we don't use any of them. Okay, let's take a 5-minute break, and when we come back, we'll keep talking about fun stuff. Hi, everyone. Welcome back. So before we dive right back into this enthralling code that we have for all of you, I do want to just mention a couple of things. First of all, we've sort of changed around the sections and scheduling and some of this other stuff to simplify and hopefully make it a little bit more a little bit easier for all of you. So we have now just one on-campus section and just one virtual section, and each of these will be recorded. The on-campus section will be immediately after lecture. The online section will generally be on Saturdays, I believe. But all of the scheduling you'll be able to find directly on the class website. No longer do you have to go to different places. The main page for office hours, different section page for the section schedule. It's all going to be right here, and will be updated dependent on whatever is up to date. And I think, correct me if I'm wrong, I think we're getting rid of labs altogether. And in place of that, we are now going to have lots and lots of office hours the week that a project is due. So not this week, right? Or do we have some office hours this week? We did a lot of these changes, so forgive me with my memory here. But I think in a couple of weeks' time, when the Android staff's choice project will be due, we will have quite a few office hours available for everybody, not only in person, but online also. Not online also. So section available online and office hours on campus for all of these things. And in addition, we will of course have walkthroughs for each of the staff's choice projects. So the first walkthrough for End Puzzle, which is going to be released very soon, David? Very soon, probably, he just has to post that the PDF is already online. The walkthrough for that will be on Thursday. And to give you an idea of what you can expect for this project, so this project is going to be quite a bit of fun. You're going to implement in Android a native game called End Puzzle, which is very similar to, I mean, it goes by a variety of names, Game of 15, Mystic Squares, Mystic Tiles, or something like that, a whole bunch of other names as well. And basically, it looks like this, where it was this plastic device that had 15 or so tiles, and you would slide around the tiles to occupy then an empty space. And the goal of the game was to then order the tiles in increasing order from 1 to 15 like this. And of course, there's variations dependent on the complexity. So there was the 8 puzzle game, which only had 8 tiles in a 3x3 square. And of course, the much larger 24 puzzle, which is 5x5 with 1 empty square. And basically, you're going to implement this not with numbers, but with images. So you will take some images in an Android application, break them up into tiles, shuffle them, and the point of the game is that people would then, or the user would then be able to unshuffle them by clicking on each of these tiles. So if this were an actual implementation, I should be able to tap on this image, and this image would then move into the place of the empty space, so on and so forth until I actually complete the game. And there's some additional specifications and features that are listed. Now, one of the things that's going to be particularly interesting is that when you shuffle it, you can't just pseudo-randomly shuffle all of the numbers or all of the tiles, because half of the configurations are going to be unsolvable, actually. So what's generally easiest is to order them in reverse order. So for example, if we have in this game of 15, instead of going from 1 to 15, we would go from 15 to 1. But there's an additional little trick in that if the width of the puzzle or the height is even, or put another way, if the number of tiles is odd, so in this case we can see we have an odd number of tiles here, you can't have 3-2-1 at the very end, you have to have 3-1-2, otherwise it's one of those unsolvable configurations. Now, in the other case that you have an 8 puzzle, which has an even number of pieces, or a 24 puzzle, which again has an even number of pieces, you can actually go ahead and reverse order that from 24 down to 1 or 8 down to 1. And I know I'm going kind of fast, all of this stuff is found in the PDF, I'm just sort of going over the idea of this project overall. Now, some of the things that you'll be asked to implement are different difficulty levels, for example, easy, medium, and hard. Easy, and they correspond to each of these squares here, where you'll just take an image, break it apart into however n many pieces is required, dependent on the difficulty level, and display that to the user. You'll have three different activities that you'll have to implement. The first one is basically just an image picker, where they're provided with a list of images, and the user selects which image they want to use as the puzzle solution. And then in the second, that will load the second activity, which will then allow the user to play the game itself. And then the third and final activity will appear when the user has successfully completed the puzzle, and that activity will congratulate the user and tell them how many moves it took them to complete the puzzle. And there's one sort of neat additional thing that that your implementation will have to do, and that is to remember state. So if the application is shut down, for example, it should remember the state so that the next time that application is open, it will come back to the state of the tiles that it was in before with the same image, so on and so forth. And this will be, I think, a fun way for you to really get your feet wet with the Android application. Now, in order for us, though, to really dive into this, we have to talk about some things that we haven't yet gotten to, but we are going to very, very soon, I hope, hopefully today, cross fingers, things like opening up new activities, opening up a menu, doing some other stuff like that, we are going to get to very soon. Now, something that I want to mention about grading, of the first project is supposed to be done by next week, so hopefully you will receive feedback by the middle to the end of next week on project one. And for these projects, except for the setup projects, we are breaking down We're breaking down the grades into basically four axes: correctness, design, scope, and style. Scope is sort of new, whereas before we had used three axes: correctness, design, and style. We've now added scope, and the scope one is meant to be sort of separate in that it's how much of the specification were you actually able to implement, whereas correctness is how correct is your implementation according to the spec. So hopefully that now provides some additional data when you are working on your project. Now, I've mentioned quite a few things that you'll have to implement. You'll see here that in big bold letters is the menu button, and a couple of other things that we'll have to do. And in order for us to start talking about all of that, we of course have to go back to all of this source code. Now, if you happen to be sitting either at home or here in the lecture hall and watching me blab about all of this stuff, note that we have just posted all of the source code, activity 03 through intense 08. We may not get through all of this code today, but we're going to get through as much of it as we can. You can go to the course website, download it, import it into Eclipse, and follow along if you want to. Okay, so any questions about what we've talked about, either the project or dialog boxes or any of this stuff, before we get back into it? Okay, so when we left off, we talked about these dialog boxes. So just to sort of hammer this idea home, recall that there is, because we have extended the activity method, or so because because our class is an extension of activity, that means that we also have available to us all of the methods that the base activity class has implemented as well. And one of those is this show dialog method. So in case that was confusing, realize that we do not implement this show dialog method. This is implemented by the activity itself elsewhere in the code, and it's sort of hand wavy. We don't actually know all that this code actually does, though we could actually look at the source code if we wanted. But one of the things that this show dialog does is run this method that we have to implement called onCreateDialog. So that's the link between show dialog and onCreateDialog. And like we talked about before, onCreateDialog will build a dialog object dependent on which dialog we actually want to open. And that one that is selected is sent to us via this integer ID parameter. And so using a switch, we're then able to determine which dialog we want to create and build it accordingly. Now, all of these, realize that when we create dialog, in order to sort of conserve memory and CPU cycles, the activity will actually preserve that dialogue associated with that ID. It's not actually going to be changed. So the first time this onCreateDialog, the first time that onCreateDialog is run for that ID will also be the only time that onCreateDialog is run for that ID. So this is problematic for this dialogue that we had just shown a minute ago that shows us the text that we had entered into this edit text box. Because the very first time that I run this, it will show us whatever text we've entered, but if I change that text, it's actually going to show the same message, because the reason for that is that that dialogue has already been created and is not going to be modified. It's not going to be recreated, because that show dialogue method is not going to call again our onCreateDialog method. Now, if we actually want to have a dialogue that changes every time that it is called, then we have to implement another method altogether called onPrepareDialog. Now, onPrepareDialog is called every single time that the system is going to open a dialogue. So this is useful for us to implement when we actually want to change the text in the dialogue itself. So in the case that we are using, that we are opening a dialogue that references that accept ID, and because that's the one that will have the text that changes every so often, that cancel one isn't going to change very much, if at all. It's that text, are you sure you want to cancel, with the yes and no buttons. That's it. We're done with that. We don't want to modify or change that, so we're not going to modify it. But if that ID is equal to is equal to the dialog accept ID, then what we want to do is set the message. We want to change the message, and in order for us to do that, we have to cast the dialog, because we're only sent this dialog. We have to cast it as an alert dialog, which then gives us access to this set message method. And with that, we can then run this, we can then pass it this same parameter. You've entered the text, and then pass it the text that was available in that text edit box, and that will be appropriately updated. Now, there is something that I do want to mention about this method. This method, it, as it's shown in this code, is actually technically deprecated in the API. Now, the reason that I'm not using the newer one is that the newer one adds an additional parameter, args, using, I think, a bundle type. And that is useful for a variety of things, but it's not backwards compatible with older versions. And in fact, when I was writing this code, it took me a little while to figure out why, when I had an additional parameter, according to the API, to have this bundle args like this, why this was working on the device, on my actual physical device, and not on the emulator. And as it turns out, the emulator was running a slightly older version of the Android OS, and it didn't understand the method. It didn't understand the newer method, and so it didn't give me an error. It didn't do anything like that. It just assumed that that method had not been implemented. This older, now deprecated method, which looks like this, looks like that it looked like to the OS that it had not been implemented, so it didn't run it. So it took a little while to figure out why the dialog box was being updated on a device and not on the emulator itself. So be mindful of that. If you are creating an application that's meant to be targeted for an older version and you see in the API that you're using a deprecated version of the function, you may have to support not only the deprecated version but also the newer version as well for backwards compatibility and also forwards compatibility. It just depends on the context there. And that's just sort of something that I think you should watch out for. Now, there's one more layout in all of this stuff that I think is going to be useful for us to talk about, and that is found in activity 10. And what this one is going to be, this is sort of directly related to the activity that you're going to have to create for this project, for this end puzzle project. And what this will do is to create a list activity, and that list will be populated dynamically by a number of options in an array. So just to see what this is going to look like, I'm going to compile and run it. No, I don't want to save code 9 because I made some silly changes. So I'm going to compile it and run it. And on the other device, are we going to see this right here? This list, which is just a very simple list full of colors. But this is what this list, and we don't define in XML or statically any of these items in this list. In fact, all of these are defined programmatically via an array. And so we could remove some items or add some items in this array as appropriate. But whenever I click on one of these items, we then see a toast that shows us the value that's associated with this item. So this is very, very useful to us, especially in the case that we might have, say, I don't know, a list of images, and we want to select one to use in the subsequent activity. So, looking back at some of the code that we have here, realize that in order for us to use this, we actually have to implement an array adapter. And there's this concept of an adapter that is sort of this intermediate link between an array or an array of objects or just some generic array and this list that exists in the layout. And in fact, you'll notice that in our XML file, we don't have a main.xml layout for this activity. There's something else that's called custom list item, but that's not related directly to the activity as a whole. So there's something that we're doing. We're generating this list activity programmatically. So in fact, if we take a look at the onCreate method, notice that one of the things that we're not doing is we're not using setContentView. There's no setContentView because there's no view yet for us to set the content to. There's no root node in these views for us to be able to use. But instead, what we want to use is this method that's, again, an activity method called setListAdapter, where we provide to it an array adapter that acts as this interface between our array of data and this list that we're going to show on the screen. So when we do this, we pass into it an array adapter, and we provide into it a couple of things. We provide it this, the activity that we're working with, which I think is actually the context of the application. Then this, which is the reference to one of the resources, as you can see, the custom list item that we had seen before, which, if we take a look at that XML file, really just defines the style for a single individual item in this list. All it is a text view with a very large font size and some padding, and we specify a width and a height, and that's it. we want the width and the height to maximize in the list view, so that the list view can then decide what the size of this text view should be. So we could pass into it either this resource, or perhaps we could create this programmatically as well. But this is a way that we are then able to specify the style of this of an individual list item. Now, the last thing we need to pass into the adapter is the array of objects that we want to deal with. And in this case, there's an array that's defined elsewhere in this code called colors. And in particular, this is an array of type string. And that's what this is over here. We are telling the array adapter what sort of data it can expect for this. And in this case, it is going to be an array of strings. So if we look down here, we can see that our array is defined down here. And this is exactly what we had seen in our code. And had I wanted to modify this, I could actually add an additional color as well, like clear or something like that. And the next time that I run this code, we should then see that in the application as well. So hopefully now here what we will see in the phone is now we have this new object clear. So we just added a new array item, and it appears now in our UI. But using an array adapter is actually pretty useful for us. And realize that when we implement this, one of the things that we have to implement also, if we want to do something with one of these items, is we have to also implement the onItemClickListener. So whereas before we had implemented only onClickListeners, this is a separate interface that allows us to interact with an item, a single individual item in the list itself. And so this necessitates a different method that we can see down here that is called onItemClick, like you can see right here. And to it, we get passed a variety of things, including an adapter view, the view that has been selected itself, the position, the ID, so on and so forth. We can actually cast then the view to the text view and retrieve the text that exists within that view and display it on the screen using, again, a toast that we had seen elsewhere. Yes?
I don't really understand why you wouldn't just have a main.xml file and have the list in there and use the set content view. Is it just not done like that?
So why wouldn't we? Okay, so that's a good question. Why wouldn't we just have a list that's defined in main.xml and just use set content view? Well, this is sort of a simplistic example in that we have sort of predefined the array here. But what if we wanted to create this array programmatically? Because, for example, we have a list of images that we want to be able to reference, and so we want to build that list at runtime and then show that list. We can't predefine that list in the XML file. We have to be able to modify it at runtime. And using this array adapter allows us to create a list view and put into it all of these items that we've created into an array and interact with each. So it gives us some additional power that hard coding all of this data into an XML file would not provide to us. And in fact, what you will see when we start getting a little bit more sophisticated and we start talking about intents, when we start looking at intents 08, this I think hopefully this array adapter, its use will be a little bit more apparent because we are actually using this a little bit more as it's intended to be used in this example at a later point in time. But for now, just realize that this sort of thing exists and it's useful for us in certain cases. Yes? Yeah, sure. So back to dialogue, uh-huh. Uh-huh. So this same code addresses your question in that if we wanted to create more than one dialogue, then do we have to create separate handlers? No, we don't have to, because notice that what we are passing in is different IDs dependent on the dialogue that we want to generate. So in the case that accept is pushed, then we call the show dialogue method, but we pass into it the accept ID. And in the case of cancel, then we pass into it the cancel ID. So these are just integer IDs. And in the method onCreateDialog, we have a switch that depends on whichever dialog or whichever ID has been passed to this function. So you'll notice that the parameter that's passed into it is this integer ID. So we get to pick based on that. If the ID that's passed to us matches this dialog cancel ID, then that's the dialog that we're going to build. If it's the other one, then we'll build the accept ID instead, or the accept dialog instead.
But so that still means you can just always only have one onCreateDialog.
Right. So you would only have one onCreateDialog, right? You wouldn't have separate ones. Yeah, you couldn't have two onCreateDialogs because they would have to be exactly the same in terms of the parameters they accept and the name itself. And that's you can't have two methods that are exactly the same like that. Yes?
So this dialog ID constant, can we just use arbitrary integer values? Can we just choose these values ourselves, or are there any constraints on them imposed by the system?
Are there any constraints posed on the system by using these IDs? And in fact, no, you can use any integers you want. I just defined these to be very simple. The cancel ID is equal to 0 and the accept ID is equal to 1. But I could have made these any acceptable value for an integer, and I don't think that it would reject any of them. It should just pass it to each of the subsequent methods. Any other questions? Okay. So now, we've seen a lot of stuff today, layouts. We've seen layouts and dialogues and toasts and array adapters and a whole variety of things. But really, this is only so useful. We've only been doing all of this stuff in the context of one activity. And we've also been talking about all of these resources, but only to a certain extent. And so in order for us to start doing things with all of these with all of these ideas, we have to start looking in more detail at both of these concepts, resources and also intents. And so when we are talking about resources, realize that some of the things that we are talking about we've already seen. So there's a couple of folders that exist within an Android application so that you can include some additional resources as well. So one of them is this resource folder called RES that we've seen before, and we've referenced a lot of objects and a lot of data within this resource folder. Some of them include the drawables, the strings, the layouts themselves, and all of these are automatically referred to by the r.java. They're automatically created as IDs in the r.java file. Now, sometimes, though, you might have sort of an advanced application where you actually need to read raw bytes. And this might if you have any sort of specific data type that you've created on your own, you might have to do this, or really any sort of fancy data type that might not be implemented by the system, then you might have to put this into assets. So anything that's external, anything that's external non-code files belongs in one of these two folders. So that includes XML files, images, sounds, anything like that. Now, if we focus on the resources folder, realize that there's a few different subdirectories that we could actually have. There's an animation folder that we could have to define some XML files for frame-by-frame animation. And unfortunately, we're not going to have time to look at that, but if you're interested in this, then that's something that you should look at in the dev website. Now, one of the things that is going to become particularly interesting for us is this res drawable. In fact, that's where you're going to put all of the images destined for your application. Okay, so other folders include the layout folders, which we've seen, values, so we'll take a look at this in just a little bit, XML, arbitrary XML files, and RAWs is where we would put raw uncompiled files. So generally, there's three general types that you would put into a non-raw folder. Those include XML files as appropriate, bitmaps or images, and that doesn't necessarily mean the bitmap file type. I mean like JPEG, PNGs, and GIFs. Those are the three major supported file types and the recommended ones, in fact, by Android. And for RAW, we would put things like sound files, video, anything else. where we would put all of this. Now, in values, we would put things like perhaps an array list or some strings list or something like that. And each of these, we can specify multiple or different versions of values dependent on a variety of factors. Now, there's something very important that I must mention about all of these things. If you put some file in one of these folders, it does have limitations on its name. And specifically, you can only have 0 through 9 in the file name, A through Z, but lowercase only, and underscore and period. So what that means is that you cannot have any uppercase characters in the file name that exists in one of these subfolders in the resource folder, or it's not going to compile. You'll get a kind of an arbitrary, they might have fixed it, but I remember a year ago even, it was sort of like a confusing name. Why is my IMG underscore 6534.jpg not being allowed? And it was just because it was just capitalized. So keep that in mind when you are looking at this information. Now, there, of course, additional information can be found on the resource section of the development page. But if you actually want to include resources in your application, it actually is relatively easy to do in Eclipse. All you have to do is you find the resource folder, and if you want to implement one of those that does not yet exist, so for example, raw, you want to add in perhaps some sound files or what have you, you can just create a subfolder in that resource folder and drag files from your computer, from your desktop, or from your hard drive directly into one of these folders. And then Eclipse will ask you if you want to copy or link the file, and then you can choose the appropriate choice dependent on the type of file that it is, and it will be included here along with the rest of the resources file. Now, if we want to actually be able to reference some of these files, of course, it's automatically generated by that r.java file. So if we take a look then, of course, at the generated file, we'll see a list of the resources that are available to us. So we have here an ID class that includes some of the IDs that we have perhaps in our layout, a drawable class for all of the items that we have in our drawable folder, which for right now is just the default icon, color, so we can specify some color. Notice that they're hexadecimal, but also additionally notice that not only is it hexadecimal, 24-bit hexadecimal, but there's also an extra 8 bits devoted to alpha as well, so we could do some transparency in our color, and we'll see an example of this in just a second, and also strings, so that we can reference strings directly by name rather than through some sort of arbitrary ID. Yes? Yes, every time you modify one of the files in the resource folder, this R file will be updated accordingly. So it happens very quickly, and at the very least, it will happen at compile time, so everything is ready at runtime for your application. Now, something that's important to realize here also is if we take a look at one of these XML files, for example, the strings file, we've perhaps seen a very simple version of this already, where we had a variety of strings defined within this XML file, and we give it an ID and also the string itself that should be represented by that ID. But notice that there's a couple of gotchas that can happen in a strings XML file. In particular, an apostrophe will cause the XML parser to go sort of awry. So you have to be careful to escape apostrophes, either by using a backslash or by putting your string in double quotes, so that your apostrophe is not interpreted as a raw apostrophe. So this commented out portion of the XML file, you'll see some things that are actually invalid. So you'll see right here, this won't work right here. This will actually cause an error during compile, and also you cannot use sort of HTML entities like you would see here, just because that ampersand will cause some problems as well in this XML file. Now, if we wanted to do something with all of these strings, I mean, you've sort of seen what this code looks like already, but we can reference each of these strings even within the layout itself just by using that ampersand symbol and the type of data it is. So in the case that we have a text view right here, we can see that we have an @string/hello2, so that we can actually change in this strings.xml file, we can update the string that's used in this text view rather than having to look in our layout itself. So again, we are separating our layout from our content by using this sort of resources. Now, moving on just a little bit, realize that we can also use colors that I had mentioned before, but there's also an additional byte at the end so that we can define some transparency as well. I'll have to defer to the documentation if you have some additional questions on that. Now, moving on, of course, this sort of brings up the obvious question of, okay, well, now you have some values in a strings.xml file. Does this mean that you can have multiple strings.xml files dependent on the language of the device, so that you could do some localization? In fact, that's exactly the point of having this idea, and you can do this by using some attributes after the name of these specified folders. So in this case, we have a values-en folder, which represents an English version of the strings, and values-es for Spanish versions of the string. And all of this happens actually quite automatically. And this can be applied not only to values, but also to drawable, to layout, so that you can include a variety of resources, not just for different languages, but also for different hardware capabilities as well. And in fact, you can actually create a very long chain of specifiers when you are trying to create a resource specific to perhaps a device, or that's very specific to some subset of features that a variety of devices might share. So we could string a whole bunch of specifiers in this way. So we could have res/drawable, for example, dash the language, dash the screen dimensions, dash the whether it's in portrait or landscape mode, and the pixel density of the screen as well. So this is very useful so that you can include some high resolution versions of your images for high resolution screens and low resolution versions for low resolution screens, so on and so forth. A different keyboard, and you can see again, a whole list of this stuff is provided also on the dev site. But basically, how it decides which one to use is sort of it's not that complicated. It just goes from left to right in terms of importance. So, for example, language is the first most important thing that exists. So, if there is a -en and a -es folder, for example, and one device is running English language and another device is running Spanish language, then it will pick the correct one dependent on that language. Now, if, for example, you make a very specific set of specifiers and a device that's running doesn't seem to match it, but it's the closest one, it will still use that dependent on this sort of priority order. But again, I'm going to have to do a little bit of hand waving just because there's a lot of specificity that you can apply here, and there's a lot of ways that you would be able to localize some folder, some resource folder for a specific device. Did I see a question? Right. Oh, I see. This I used to make it clear that this is not only English but regional to the United States. So that's just to make it a little bit more clear, rather than en-rus, which could be perhaps confused with another language entirely or something else altogether. So this is just an example. Again, do as I say, not as I do. This is provided here just to make it a little bit more clear about how you can chain some of these specific attributes together to target a specific device. Okay, but if we have this as an example, this is actually picked automatically by the device. So if I want to see what this looks like, realize that I have run this application on the device right here. And right now, we've gone back to basics. This is very simple, just a very simple text view. We can see that we have a Hello World text that's available here. And notice, additionally, that it is named, that it has a specific name in the starter right here. So CS76 Lecture Intense 02 as well. But if I were to change the language of this device, language and keyboard, from English United States to Spanish United States, then go back. Notice that it is now, the device is now in Spanish, and most everything has been updated to reflect the new language, except some of these actually don't support now another language. And in fact, we will see that happens in a variety of these applications as well, where some of these have reverted, in fact, back to English, just because of their of the strings that they have in their strings.xml file. But if I run this application again, let's see. So I come back here and I want to run it. We should see, hopefully, that the text, even though I have not changed anything, the text has been changed to reflect the new language that exists. So localization is very easy, just based on specifying the folder that you want to contain your strings.xml file. And just to hammer this idea home, here's the English version of the strings.xml file, and there is the Spanish version of it as well, as you can see here. And so each of these would then, whichever language the device happens to be in at the time, that is the one that will be used for this for the device itself. Any questions on this? Okay. Oh yes. How did my application know that English was the default? I'm not quite sure which you mean. Oh, I see. So in the case where, if there's only one values folder, for example, then the device has no choice to pick that one as the default for the strings.xml file. Generally, this is specified much more exactly in the dev guide online as well. But generally, it will try to pick the closest one. I think generally it defaults to English language in the case that that another language does not exist or a language localization does not exist. But that might be able to be modified in Android as well. You can probably pick a different default language if your specific language does not happen to be exist in the localization of that app. Okay. Now moving on, in Intenso 3, we want to work with some of the other resources that exist as well. And in particular, what we want to start dealing with are some of the images that can exist in an image, it can exist in an app. So notice that I have here four images, and these are named appropriately. They're not capitalized, notice. And in this case, all we want to do is then be able to use these images in our application. So what is this going to look like on our device? So running this on our device, we should hopefully see this in just a second. We can see here that there is an image shown on the screen. And the document camera thinks it's out of focus, which it actually kind of is. So here, what is going on with this code? Well, in order for us to reference an image, notice that all we have to do is just pick, just pull an image from the resource, that same R resource file that's been generated for us, and set set an image view equal to to use that image resource that exists. So in this case, this is just a very very basic layout. We just have a very simple image view that exists in our layout, and within it we have to connect to it programmatically. But from that, there is a method in the image view type that allows us to set the image to a resource, and we can then specify the resource or the integer that that exists in that file. R.java that was generated for us. And again, this translates, this correlates very well with just the name that we've provided this this image. So in the case that, to go back to localization, if you have a few different images, one that's low resolution, that's destined for low resolution screens, and one that's medium resolution and high resolution, you would give them all the same name. You would just put them in the different folders. And then that way, whenever Android wants to use the appropriate version of that, dependent on the selection for that device, then all you have to do, you don't have to do anything different in your code. You will just automatically pick the same name from the appropriate resource folder so that you can just continue working without having to deal with localizations. So with that, we are then just able to use very easily this resource integer, put it into this method set image resource, and then open and display that that image on our view. Now for the next one, this is sort of fun as well. What if we want to start working with sound as well? Well, there exists this class called a media player, and in this media player, we'd be able to run some sound. So we have here another application that is starting to build up in how interesting it is. Here's another image that we've loaded into the resources folder, and there is a button that's right here, and it's occurring to me right now that this is going to be altogether too quiet, but I'm going to try playing it anyway. So if I click vroom vroom, wait, is it? I think it's on vibrate even. Okay, I'm going to make this loud. Oh, it's still in Spanish too. How about that? Okay. All right, do you hear that? All right, so now it's actually making a noise. And so you'll notice that when I click this vroom vroom button, notice that the button changes to say emergency brake. And when I hit that, the sound will actually stop playing. So how does this work? Well, you can, of course, take a look at all of the code. But for now, I think we're going to have to wrap up. And we will continue talking about resources and intents, how to create an activity, and even start activities from other applications next week. And until then, thank you all for coming. And we'll see you then. Thank you.